This is the RNL Revolution Nothing Less Show, episode number 90, on February 24th, 2022. My name is Andy Zee. I'm the host of the show, coming to you from Los Angeles, California. I come to you as what threatens to be the largest land war in Europe since World War II looms, with Russian troops ordered into the Ukraine and the first major explosions announced. This unfolds by the hour after weeks and really years of threats and provocations and responses by the US and Europe on the one side and Russia on the other. The danger should not be underestimated, and I will return to this shortly. Every episode of the RNL show brings the way out of the madness and horror that confronts literally billions of people all over the world. Every week, we bring you nothing less than the liberating truth that the way out of the horrors of today is through getting prepared and organized for an actual revolution to overthrow the system of capitalism imperialism that is at the root of all the misery, oppression, repression, devastation of the air, water, and climate, and the wars that confront humanity and threaten the future. The RNL show brings you nothing less than a revolution for the emancipation of all humanity. Our show is grounded in, and it brings to you, the work and the leadership of Bob Avakian, B.A., a revolutionary who cut his teeth in the revolutionary movements of the 1960s, and he has never given up, but instead has pushed forward, developing the science of communism, the science of revolution, which is now the new communism. In this moment, we need leadership like this. B.A. has developed a strategy for making a real revolution, and he has written a constitution for a socialist republic in North America, a visionary blueprint for a radically new and far better society that is on the road to real emancipation. As I am recording this introduction and we are editing this 90th episode of our show late on Wednesday night, reports are coming in that there have been major explosions in or near Kiev, a modern city of 3 million people, which is also one of the oldest cities in Europe, and it is the capital of the Ukraine, an independent sovereign country on the border of Russia. Before this news, earlier on Wednesday, we recorded a conversation with Lenny, Wolff, and Noche, Diaz that presents the basic facts of the situation in Ukraine and a revolutionary orientation to this development. That will be our first segment after my introduction. Last week, we began the RNL Revolution Nothing Less show by posing sharp, serious questions. All right. We're going to be
all right. Huh? We're going to be all right. Really? We're going to be all right. It's all good.
The greatest existential threat of all.
Don't you fucking move, I'm gonna shoot you in your fucking head, you hear me?
Warning tonight of a world war. United States and Russia engaged in a firefight.
A record-breaking increase in asylum seekers.
And we're gonna get them out.
Abortion rights are under attack.
Overrules Roe versus Wade entirely.
What are you doing now? What are you thinking? What will you do?
What are you doing? What are you thinking? What will you do? It's not gonna be all right. In fact, as events today make real, it is getting worse and more serious by the day. Last week, in speaking to these questions on the RNL show, I spoke of conscience, of the need to stand up and act against injustice, to fight for a radically new world and society, to claim or to reclaim your humanity by refusing to accept the future that this system and those who lord over it are leading to. Today's show, we're going to focus on and dig deeper into that reality. We are going to speak to just two of the crises that are roiling the world and this country. The first is the situation in the Ukraine. What's happening, why, and what are the interests of humanity? Then our main focus will be the right to abortion that hangs in the balance. This battle could not be more urgent or more brutally impactful on the lives and the future of all women in this country, with repercussions internationally. More, the fight to strip women of the right to abortion has been the battering ram of a Christian fascist movement that is at the core of and provides the shock troops for the Republican Fascist Party led by Donald Trump. The Democratic Party and the official women's movement tied to it have given up in advance, refusing to mount resistance. The co-hosts of the RNL show, Sunsara Taylor, and others have stepped into the breach and are calling for and organizing for taking to the streets in sustained, determined mass struggle. The stakes concentrate much for our future. The situation we face, not just in this battle, but overall in this country, is one of two possible futures, either something terrible or something truly emancipating. This is not something I say for dramatic effect. This is the reality we are living. And it is the main title of a work essential for our time by Bob Avakian. This is the most important work you can read right now to know and to deal with what we face. Why? Because it is the only analysis that gets to the root of the problem in the capitalist imperialist system we live under and the shape this is taking in the intractable divisions in this country from the very top of the government down through every institution and viciously, violently, and we can say virally between two opposed peoples. This great divide in its irreconcilable extremeness and the horror it could bring also contains the potential for something positive, a real revolution. Something terrible or something truly emancipating provides the framework and roadmap to a future that really could be truly emancipating. It is the framework and basic roadmap to that future. Pause on that. Think about it. A possible future that would lift the burden, the horror, the existential threat of a system that threatens war, environmental catastrophe, if not extinction, the overcoming of all forms of oppression. Where is your responsibility to humanity, to the future, if you don't seriously read and engage this work and the work of BA, the author and leader of the movement for an actual revolution? You can find Something Terrible or Something Truly Emancipating on our website, revcom.us. With this, let's begin with Ukraine. Late Wednesday night, we posted this on our website, revcom.us.
In a heinous act dripping with hypocrisy, Vladimir Putin announced he was sending in his army to demilitarize and denazify Ukraine. This is nothing but grotesque imperialist bullshit to justify a move to protect the capitalist imperialist interest of Russia. In words which were even more hypocritical, American political players from Biden on down self-righteously deplore this move, while conveniently ignoring the US's own history of doing exactly the same kind of thing, except qualitatively more frequently and on a much more horrendous scale. And of course, Biden very conveniently covered over the ways in which the US and NATO have goaded this on.
So with that as an introduction, let's go to the conversation between Lenny Wolff, who is a leader of the RevComs and a writer for RevCom.us, and Noche Diaz, who is the spokesperson for the Revolution Clubs nationally.
Hi, I'm Lenny Wolff. I'm a follower of Bob Avakian and an advocate for the new communism. As we record this, Russia has recognized two regions of what had been part of the country of Ukraine as independent of Ukraine, and they have sent troops into those regions. This provocation by Russia unjustly violates the sovereignty of Ukraine. As you can see from the map, Ukraine is a sizable country of 43 million people bordering Russia. The U.S. and its allies have responded with economic sanctions or penalties against Russia, suspending contracts, freezing bank accounts of some high officials and some government entities, and forbidding certain imports and exports. As U.S. Defense Secretary Austin backhandedly admitted, these sanctions will impose suffering and immense sacrifice on the Russian people. And as the website revcom.us points out, the U.S. has been politically and militarily encircling Russia since the collapse of the Soviet Union in 1991, of which Russia was part. At that time, the U.S. began drawing new countries into the NATO military alliance it heads, installing troops and nuclear-capable weaponry close to Russian borders. And 8 years ago, the United States supported the ouster of a government friendly to Russia and then developed economic and military ties with this new Ukrainian government. Now the U.S. claims to be outraged at Russia's moves. Want to know how seriously to take that outrage? Here's a hint from history. In 1961, the United States sponsored and militarily supported an invasion of the sovereign nation of Cuba. The invasion was defeated, but the U.S. continued with its threats and subversion and outright sabotage of Cuba. In 1962, Cuba asked the Soviet Union to install missiles in the country to deter the United States from another attack. When the U.S. found out about it, it threatened to plunge the entire world into nuclear war until those missiles were withdrawn 12 days later. As Bob Avakian has pointed out, the United States always claims to be the good guys, who can therefore carry out all sorts of crimes and threats that would be opposed if any other country were to do them. Back to today, though, the United States and NATO have sent troops and weaponry to countries close to Russia, in addition to arming Ukraine itself. The threat of a wider war, which would immediately entail tremendous suffering and death for people in Ukraine, and which could spiral into something horrific and even catastrophic, is not just in the air, but is a live possibility. Today, we'll get into what interests are driving this. Where do the interests of humanity lie in this situation? And how do these events relate to the revolution we so urgently need? To do that, we've asked Noche Diaz, national spokesperson for the Revolution Club, to help sort all this out. Noche, how do you see the situation?
Well, one thing is, I really appreciate you pulling the lens back, because I think everybody is being bombarded day in and day out with the sort of in a soap opera like drama of what's going on with the ins and outs, who's doing what and who's lying to who and who's making this move and that move. And, you know, people, if things escalate and as things escalate, are being trained to think of, oh, who started it and who made the first move and all of this or that. And what people need to do is actually go back to how this, you know, how this has been developing over years and decades in terms of, you know, not just conflicts between Biden and Putin, but between a whole block of imperialism headed by the U.S. and Russia's attempt to forge its own block of, you know, rival gangsters competing over the turf and the corners. And so, you know, I think it's very important that people not get sucked into and roped into all of this, you know, stuff that really stupefies and mystifies everything into what they tell you is what happened on, you know, yesterday or the day before that, and actually look at the bigger picture and what's going on. And you know, this is something that people really do not know anything about what is going on there or internationally. You know, overall, when you walk through NATO and how it was, first of all, an alliance, a military alliance for the U.S. to, you know, and its allies to help isolate the Soviet Union, and now in rivalry with Russia and its attempts to form its new imperialist bloc. Or the way in which, you know, these missile systems that you refer to, the MK-41s, have been used thousands of times as offensive weaponry by the U.S. to attack different places all around the country whenever it deems in its interests. Or the fact that sanctions are used repeatedly by the U.S. as weapons of war and kill off thousands of people, including attempts to target children. And its intention is to actually cause that kind of suffering, to be used as a violent means to impose the will of the U.S. and to force people to bend their knee to the imperialist interest of the U.S. And in basic from Bob Avakian, I just want to read this, you know, very quickly for people, because it helps cut through a lot of this and the way in which they try to train us to think about world events. Basics, this is 3.8. The interests, objectives, and grand designs of the imperialists are not our interests. They're not the interests of the great majority of people in the U.S., nor of the overwhelming majority of people in the world as a whole. And the difficulties the imperialists have gotten themselves into in pursuit of these interests must be seen and responded to not from the point of view of these imperialists and their interests, but from the point of view of the great majority of humanity and the basic and urgent need of humanity for a different and better world, for another way.
Well, that brings up an interesting point. Where do the interests of humanity lie if they don't lie with one or another of these imperialist powers?
In the Revolution Club, we have 6 points of attention for the revolution. And number 3 is that we're fighting for a world without borders, where people of different languages, cultures, and races are equals. That is what's in the interest of humanity, not siding or lining up behind one or another imperialist in their attempt to carve up the world and compete with each other over how to exploit the people and plunder the planet. Our interest is in overthrowing these imperialists and getting rid of their system and bringing into being a communist world that truly is free of all those divisions amongst people.
So you're saying we're not for one side or the other?
We are not, but let me tell you, we're also for any defeat, setback, embarrassment, and any kind of loss that the U.S. suffers through this process, because this country, the United States, is one of the biggest gangsters and imperialist powers on the planet. And you want to talk about the interests of the people of the world? Bringing this empire down is one of the greatest things we can do in the interests of humanity. And when they suffer setbacks, even against people who we don't like, because Putin and Russia are no good, let's be clear. But even when they suffer defeats versus people we don't like and who are no good, that can actually strengthen the struggle of the people to bring down the system right here in the belly of the beast. And that's what we are working towards.
I think that's really important. And there was a show previously that we did when this crisis was just beginning to bubble up. And at that show, I said that this is a war between slave masters. This is a war to, on either side, to defend and expand slavery. And in such a war, our interests lie in using the defeats of either side to overthrow the whole system of slavery. And somebody, this is a question I really want to ask you, because some of the people who were applauding that were saying in the comments section, yeah, we got to let the white people fight amongst themselves, and then we can take over. What do you say to somebody who says that?
No. And in the Revolution Club, again, you will learn the points of attention. And number 4 says we are going for the emancipation of all humanity. And we don't lose sight of the potential of people, even the most oppressed, to do that. And our responsibility to struggle with people to rise to that. We don't tolerate revenge. This is the way this system degrades us, gets us acting and thinking in the ways of this system. Gets us forgetting that the point of what you were saying was that we are trying to get free, not to get in or to become another one of the people who gets to look at and laugh at other people who are suffering and being oppressed under this system, whether they're white, black, brown, yellow, or any other, you know, purple, green, I don't care, okay? If you're actually finding to put an end to that, you're not just going to welcome people slaughtering each other. You are again welcoming the defeats of these imperialists as part of bringing them down and getting everybody free, including, yes, the masses of people who are in Ukraine or Russia are part of the people of the world who need to be part of struggling to get everybody free. Okay, so this is what you'll learn in the revolution, and this is the principles, the methods, and the standards that the revolutionaries need to be applying and modeling for people. We don't have to act like them who rule over us. We have to act like emancipators of humanity.
Noche, I think that really captures something critically important. I want to tell our viewers that every week at the website revcom.us, the Revolution Club has a page through which you can get organized and get hooked up and learn about the next activities of the club and find out where you need to be going and what you need to be doing. So I hope to have a further discussion with you. Let's see what develops here, and I'm sure we'll see the Revolution Club out there.
Abortion on demand and without apology. Now is the time to act. February 27th, St. Patrick's Cathedral, New York City. March 8th, International Women's Day, New York City and everywhere. Sunsara Taylor speaks, forced motherhood is female enslavement.
So close to 10 years ago, at a rally that I led at Union Square for abortion rights here in New York City, a woman who was just walking by stopped and listened for a while. She came close to the edge of the stage, and I noticed that she was shaking. So I went over and I talked to her, and she told me, through tears, a story that she had held in silence for probably 40 or 50 years. She told me about being 16 years old, growing up in Biloxi, Mississippi, and how her best friend, also 16, found out that she was pregnant. Her best friend, her family was Catholic, and she was so ashamed, and she especially didn't want to tell her father. Now, I want you to remember what it was like to be 16. I want you to picture your best friend. Think about the hopes you had, the dreams for your future. And now think about the isolation, the shame, the terror you would have to feel at 16 to go and rummage through your father's things. Look for where he kept his gun, take it out, point it at your head, and pull the trigger. This is what this woman's best friend did. This is what it means when abortion, legal, safe abortion, is criminalized and not available. There is a ticking time bomb of female enslavement that is set to be detonated by the Supreme Court in a matter of months. There is no hiding from it. And the choice that each of us has to make is, are we going to confront it? Are we going to fight to change it? Are we going to rally and wake up everybody we can to join us? Or are we going to let it explode and shatter the lives of millions and rain a cloud of shame, suffocation, humiliation, and enslavement over generations of women and girls? Don't waste another day. Seize today, tomorrow, and every day between now and March 8th to turn people out. And join Lori Sokol and myself and others at St. Patrick's Cathedral on February 27th for a speak out to shatter the silence and the shame and to put it on the line, including nonviolent civil disobedience, to make clear the stakes and galvanize others. Join in whatever ways and every way you can. Give your funds, give your talents, give your networks, give your creativity, give your time and your courage. Now is the time. I want to close with the words from the Rise Up for Abortion Rights statement. Now is the time to hold nothing back. Now is the time to rouse thousands and soon millions in struggle so that we can look every woman and girl in the eye with the promise, in word and deed, that they will have a future as full human beings, not incubators. Now is the time to stand up together as if our lives depended on it, for in fact they do. Let us rise together. Let us refuse to let the Supreme Court deny women's humanity and decimate their rights. Let's fight and demand abortion on demand and without apology.
That was Sunsara Taylor on February 16th in New York City at Revolution Books in a speech titled, Forced Motherhood is Female Enslavement. Sunsara is leading the movement, Rise Up for Abortion Rights, that's aimed at turning back the assault on abortion rights from the Supreme Court. I want to welcome Sunsara to the RNL show now.
All right, Andy, it's so good to be with you. Thank you.
Sunsara, it's good to have you on the show. You are the co-host of the show, and now you're leading this movement. This is really important. So look, I think it'd be important to set up for our audience exactly what's happening right now with the Supreme Court and what needs to be done.
Yeah, well, I think in the story that you played from that speech I gave, you get a sense of just how central, how devastating it is, how shattering it is to women's lives when they do not have the ability to control for themselves when and whether to have a child. To take this right away, to force women to have children against their will, or to drive them to desperate measures to try to terminate their pregnancies, their unwanted pregnancies, in dangerous ways, this is a form of enslavement. And this is exactly what the Supreme Court is poised to impose on the lives of women in this country in a few short months. They are on track. They're currently have heard the arguments in an abortion ban out of Mississippi that if they let it stand, which they indicated, this fascist majority in the Supreme Court indicated they are on track to do, would shred abortion rights in this country and possibly even overturn Roe v. Wade legal abortion nationwide. And if that happens, I just want to make clear, this would be half the states in this country already have laws on the books, nearly half, that would ban completely or severely restrict abortion. Almost the entire Deep South, most of the Midwest would lose access to abortion overnight. This would be female enslavement writ large, and it's part of a rolling juggernaut. So it's very urgent, as I said in that speech, that people get in the streets and stand up to stop this. If you are not acting to stop this, if you are not fighting against this and mobilizing others, then you are choosing the enslavement of women. It's that simple.
Sunsara, I want to pull the lens back a bit and also go a little bit deeper by bringing to people an excerpt from the talk that I referenced at the top of our show by Bob Avakian, Something Terrible or Something Truly Emancipating. In this talk, he pulls the lens right back to the situation we're facing right now, which is a fascist movement in this country that is gaining ground, is seeking to come back to power. This is the fascist Republican Party, enthralled to and headed up by Donald Trump. And they're aiming to bring about an entire agenda that includes, as a central part of it, the subordination of women. And abortion has been the right to abortion has been the battering ram for this program over decades, but it won't stop there. They intend to get rid of the right to birth control, as well as to go after LGBTQ rights. But in this particular segment, Bob Avakian pulls the lens back and goes deeply into the oppression of women and the yearning to be free from that oppression and how this can be a major force for change. So let's watch Bob Avakian, or the segment that we've prepared with his voice, from Something Terrible or Something Truly Emancipating.
Here is another profound truth. Even with all the ways that the heavy chains of hundreds and thousands of years of oppressive tradition weigh down on the masses of people and place a heavy burden, particularly on the half of humanity that is female, there is a deep yearning to be free of all this, which not only leads to imaginary hopes of supernatural salvation, but also erupts in unrestrained fury right in this real world. And that fury needs to be fully called forth, given a scientific revolutionary expression, focused toward the emancipation of all the oppressed and exploited of the world, and ultimately all humanity, directed to fighting against the fundamental source of all the suffering. This system of capitalism imperialism, with its suffocating and brutal patriarchal male supremacy, along with all its other outrages. This takes on even more powerful meaning and urgent importance in the current situation in this country and others, where the forceful assertion of raw misogyny, hatred of women, and patriarchal subjugation of women is becoming more blatant and unbridled, focused to a significant degree now in the escalating moves to even further deny women control over their own lives and their very bodies, with a right to abortion and even birth control being brought under mounting attack. Right now, this slogan and call needs to be taken up broadly and made a powerful material force. Break the chains. Unleash the fury of women as a mighty force for revolution.
Sunsara, I'd like you to comment on that, the deep and profound rage that Bob Avakian speaks of in this segment from something terrible or something truly emancipating. And also at the end, you could see some of the, we had some footage of the uprisings around abortion rights that have taken place around the world. And there's just been this tremendous victory in Colombia based on people taking to the streets. They've just won the a decision in their Supreme Court to legalize abortion.
That's right. Well, BA speaks to the profound fury that exists within women all over the world, and yes, in this country, that is often suppressed, but sometimes erupts. And as he says, unbridled, unrestrained fury. And this is a mighty force for revolution, for revolutionary change, for resistance, and yes, for an actual revolution. And you see it. As you saw the images that were beautifully put together with his voice delivering that excerpt from the speech of women rising up in Poland, women rising up in Mexico, the fury of women unleashed in Argentina, other parts of the world. And you saw it. One of the most beautiful things that should fill everybody's heart with joy was the faces of the women in the streets in Colombia. Earlier this week, when the Supreme Court's decision came down to decriminalize abortion there, this was fought out. Women's fury was unleashed, and it changed what was possible in that country, just like it tore down the criminalization of abortion in Mexico last year. It legalized abortion in Argentina. This was the force that did it. It was women. And I wanted to make note of something very important, which is that every one of the pictures I saw of the joyous faces, the furious relief that women were feeling celebrating in Colombia earlier this year, I mean, earlier this week, every single photo was in the streets, which is where you need to be if you want to fight to advance the cause of women and others to stand up against oppression. And it's very notable that in Colombia, Argentina, Mexico, where women's rights are advancing around abortion, they've been in the streets, whereas here we're going in the opposite direction. The Supreme Court has got a juggernaut of enslavement coming after women's rights here, ready to shred abortion rights in this country. And the streets are quiet. People are quiet. They're staying home. They're not acting on this. And this is something that has to change, because the fury that BA was speaking about, that exists here too. It's currently suppressed, but we have to get out there. We have to call it forward, and we have to do this right now urgently so that it can stop this assault that is coming.
Sunsara, speaking of unleashing the fury of women as a mighty force, I want to go to an interview that Michelle Chai of the Revolution Club in Los Angeles did via Zoom with a woman from Texas, Araceli Herrera. This interview is in Spanish. There are subtitles. I want to urge our audience to stay with it. It's really compelling. And if you're just listening to this as a podcast, when you get home, go and take a look at this interview. It's on revcom.us and on our page, YouTube's at the Revcoms. Let's listen now.
So, si quiere empezar diciéndonos un poco de quién es usted y qué es esa historia que quiere compartir con personas en este momento.
Bueno, mi nombre es Araceli Herrera. Soy de la Ciudad de México y yo vivo en San Antonio, Texas. Y soy una trabajadora del hogar, limpio casas. Yo quiero compartir mi historia porque yo nunca la había compartido, nunca le había contado a nadie esto que me pasó, aunque fue algo tan fuerte que toda mi vida me afectó, me destruyó mi vida. Por eso terminé lejos de mi familia, de mi país, de mis cosas, por esto que me pasó. Cuando yo era muy joven, yo siempre digo que era una joven llena de ilusiones, llena de sueños. Ella era soñadora y yo nunca me imaginé que existía la maldad a tal grado como para destruir a alguien, ¿verdad? Entonces, yo vivía en unas colonias tan pobres que había mucha violencia. Se vendían drogas en las calles, muchos jóvenes se metían en las drogas y se morían en las calles. O sea, era muy, muy feo. Y yo siempre pensé, yo era la mayor de siete, tengo cinco hermanas y un hermano, el más pequeño, que por cierto, él terminó en las calles. Yo dije, la única manera de salir de aquí es estudiar, y estaba yo estudiando el colegio, cuando un grupo de compañeros yo estaba en un equipo para hacer un trabajo para el colegio, y entonces yo fui con este equipo y ellos me violaron, destruyeron mi vida, destruyeron todas mis ilusiones, y yo era tan inocente, tan tonta que yo no le dije a nadie. O sea, fue tan doloroso, tan traumático eso que me pasó, que yo no le dije a nadie, yo no le dije a mis padres. Y no es que tenía miedo, es que estaba impactada por lo que me hicieron, ¿verdad? Que me violaron. Y yo también nunca pensé, era tan inocente, a pesar de que estaba en el colegio, que yo nunca pensé que uno se embarazaba, ¿verdad? Y yo no me di cuenta que estaba embarazada hasta que tenía 3 meses. Entonces yo dije, ¿ahora qué voy a hacer? Y yo ahí en el colegio hay enfermería y fui y le dije a la enfermera que estaba embarazada y lo que me había pasado. Y entonces yo le dije que yo no quería tener ese hijo porque yo no sabía de quién era. Mi padre me iba a matar. Si mi padre se enteraba que yo estaba embarazada y me iba a matar, y a mi mamá también, porque mi padre era muy violento. Él me quería mucho, pero él estaba bien orgulloso que yo estaba estudiando, y como era la mayor, mi padre siempre decía que yo era la ilusión de la familia. Hace cuenta como que si yo los iba a salvar de esa miseria. Entonces yo tenía mucho miedo, yo nunca le dije nada a mi papá y a mi mamá, y no se daban cuenta. Y entonces yo hasta que dejé de ir al colegio porque ya no podía ir, porque los compañeros de la escuela se empezaron a dar cuenta de mi estómago que empezó a crecer y se burlaban de mí los hombres. Me decían cosas, me insultaban porque yo estaba embarazada. Yo no sabía qué hacer, entonces nunca le dije a mi mamá. Y así pasó el tiempo, y entonces una vez me acuerdo que estaba en la parada, en una esquina cerca de donde vivo, y ya se me veía un poquito más el vientre. Y unas muchachas que estaban ahí en la farmacia, eran dueñas de una farmacia, una de ellas se subió al segundo piso de la casa y me aventó una cubeta de agua. ¿Te imaginas qué duro fue para mí lo que sufrí por culpa de esos miserables desgraciados que me violaron? Entonces yo quise abortar, y yo en el colegio le dije, yo quiero abortar, yo no quiero tener este hijo, no puedo. En primera, porque soy joven, soy una niña. Yo no trabajo, yo estoy estudiando, yo tengo sueños, yo quiero graduarme, quiero salir de aquí. Y me dijeron no, me dijeron muchas cosas, me regañaron muy feo en los de la enfermería y me corrieron de la escuela. Perdí todo, todo perdí. Perdí mi vida, perdí mis ilusiones, mis sueños, perdí todo. Y de ahí solo fue rodar y rodar toda la vida. A mí me gustaría que los políticos en ese momento fueran y dijeran, ah, te vamos a ayudar, nosotros hacemos las leyes y te vamos a apoyar. Pero no, tú vas por el mundo rodando, golpe tras golpe, sufriendo con una criatura que tú no quieres. Y por eso yo estoy a favor de que la mujer debe de tener el derecho de decidir. Porque si yo hubiera hecho eso, no se hubiera desgraciado mi vida.
Pues muchas gracias por esta entrevista y me da mucho, estoy muy emocionada de conocerla al fin de este mes y salir a las calles juntas y vamos a impactar y vamos a llamar a toda esa gente que tiene que salir a las calles ahora.
Sí, y vamos a lograrlo.
Yes.
Porque la razón está de nuestro lado. Uh-huh. Porque la razón está de nuestro lado.
Yeah, pues muchas gracias.
De nada.
You know, Andy, I just have to say that the courage it takes for Araceli to take this story, the shame that was put on her, the thousands of years of traditions, shame and chains on women that not only told her that somehow she was wrong for being gang raped, that told her family that somehow she was wrong, that made her feel the need to flee, that forced her to have a child of this rape, and to live her whole life shaped by that, shattered by that, and to take that and come up to New York City and speak that and indict that in front of St. Patrick's Cathedral together with others and to turn that into fury and use that to call forward others. We need more of this because right now there are, we don't know how many more Araceli's being created every day in Texas already. Texas has a near total abortion ban. Girls. Women are being turned away, rape victims, incest victims, women of all ages who just don't want to have a child at that age. This nightmare that Araceli lived is the future that is being imposed if we don't stand up and act. So her, what the courage it took her to share that, it's so important, and we need to build on that. It's just because that's the reality, one way or the other.
Yeah, and I understand she's coming up to New York City this weekend to be with you at St. Patrick's Cathedral, and she's going to be with us in New York through International Women's Day. Is that right?
Yeah, she's coming up for the whole period to speak in front of St. Patrick's Cathedral at the Speak Out on Sunday, February 27th at 1:30 p.m. in New York, and staying all the way through. She's going to be speaking to church groups, speaking to classrooms, telling her story and mobilizing people together with others to be out in the streets on March 8th, International Women's Day.
Well, look, these stories, that one, this one story you told earlier of the 16-year-old from your speech, these break your heart, but they also should fill people with fury, with anger. It's just to me that this is happening and there aren't people in the streets. It's just an outrage that we cannot tolerate, not just because what already exists, but because of the potential that could be unleashed and the horror of what would happen if we don't do this. And, you know, that story of Colombia and the rising there and in Poland and other places so inspired. So, Sunsara, what the hell is up here with the streets being empty?
Well, you know, one thing that has to be noted, first of all, everybody hearing this needs to act and needs to mobilize others to act because it's on us to start this. But I want to say that one of the big things standing in the way, actually suffocating the rage and pacifying people when they should be woken up, is the so-called leaders of the so-called women's movement. These people are so enslaved to this system and so wed to the Democratic Party and their road of capitulation, their refusal to fight the fascists over this question of abortion rights. They're so enslaved that they are out there telling people, don't worry, it's not going to be that bad. Let's just prepare for after Roe v. Wade. They're not telling the truth and the full ugly of what is already happening and what is coming. And in fact, they're literally capitulating in advance. They're saying, we'll just get ready. We'll help women travel to other states. Never mind that it's more and more states where abortion is banned. You're not going to raise enough money to travel all those women to other states. They say, oh, well, some of them say we're going to teach women how to induce their own abortions. Give them the abortion pill, as if that won't soon be criminalized if this continues, and as if it doesn't matter if the state is telling you that you're legally an incubator whose life matters less than something growing inside of you. That matters. And then you have the groups like the more mainstream so-called leaders of the women's movement. I want to quote this one because it's just so unbelievable. The National Institute for Reproductive Health, which is a national movement organizing in the legal arena to pass new laws. They put out a report in 2021 that says gaining ground, the title gaining ground in 2021. And they say on their website, the pullout quote, despite historic setbacks, states passed more proactive legislation in 2021 than ever before. This momentum must continue. If you read this, you think we're making progress. But in reality, 2021 is the year that there were nearly 100 anti-abortion restrictions passed into law, the most ever passed in a single year. 2021 is the year that 6 million women of reproductive age in Texas had the right to abortion taken from them, a near total ban by the state, enforced by vigilantes. 2021. 2021 is the year that the Supreme Court of this country, the fascist packed Supreme Court, heard the case that could overturn abortion rights nationwide and made clear to the country and the world that they are on track to do so. And 2021, this pro-choice movement group says we want to keep this momentum going. This is so dishonest. It's such a disorienting lie. And it's putting people to sleep precisely when they need to be woken up and mobilized. And so this is one of the things that we have to call out. But then we also have to do the work to reach people way beyond them. Go over the heads and around the arms of this so-called movement and reach the people whose lives are going to be impacted and shattered, who feel that fury or who in whom that fury can be aroused if we go and take them the truth and we give them a way to act on it and we act ourselves. And this is something that has to be kicked off very urgently. And there's no reason. There's no reason in the world we can't make what happened in Colombia happen here, what happened in Mexico happen here, and change the direction of this country.
Yeah, Sunsara, I just want to say something to the young people, because they'll hear this and they might go out to some of the elders, their teachers or whatever, and they're going to say, oh, those people don't understand the political reality today. You know, they don't understand about how we're going to actually fight this. We have a strategy to go through elections over the next 40 years, and going in the streets doesn't really help us right now. We'll lose elections. But you know what? This shit's been going on for a really long time, and I want to play something that's really sharp from the great artist, late artist, Gil Scott-Heron, who really is the originator of spoken word and one of the originals of what became hip hop later on. And people should look him up and listen to his music. But he did a poem in the mid 70s called The New Deal. I want to play that right now because it speaks right to these people, which we used to call them suits, but now some of them might be wearing dresses.
It'll be all right. Just keep things cool and take the people off the street. We'll settle all this at the conference table. You just leave everything to me, which gets me back to my convictions and being convicted for my beliefs. Because I believe these smiles in three-piece suits with gracious liberal demeanor took our movement off of the streets and took us to the cleaners. In other words, we let up the pressure, and that was all part of their plan. And every day we allow it to slip through our fingers is playing right into their hands.
That was the great poet Gil Scott-Heron in the poem The New Deal, and he ended the poem by saying, in other words, we let up the pressure, and that was all part of their plan, and every day we allow to slip through our fingers is playing right into their hands. Sunsara, you did an interview with an abortion provider in New York City, somebody I personally and all of us have stood shoulder to shoulder with over some decades in fighting for abortion rights, Merle Hoffman. So I'd like you to introduce this interview that you did this past week.
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to sharing this with everybody. I spoke with Merle Hoffman, who, as you said, is a longtime abortion provider. She is the CEO and founder of Choices Women's Medical Center out in Queens, New York. She's an author and activist, and she is one of the initiating signers to the RiseUpForAbortionRights.org movement. And she's one of the organizers, together with myself, of the Speak Out happening this Sunday at St. Patrick's Cathedral in New York City, as well as the protests on March 8th for International Women's Day. And I want you to know that we're going to release the full extended interview on our channel in the next day or two, so you're going to want to come back and see the entire thing. In this interview, I'll reference some history that we clipped out of this shortened edit for the show tonight. Don't be distracted by it. It's a great interview. Just make sure you come back and watch the full thing in a day or two. Okay, so it is my great pleasure to welcome to the RNL, the Revolution Nothing Less show, Merle Hoffman. She is a longtime activist, author, and the CEO and founder of Choices Women's Medical Center in Queens. She is an initiating signer to the RiseUpForAbortionRights.org statement and an organizer of both the February 27th Speak Out Around Abortion Rights at St. Patrick's Cathedral and March 8th for International Women's Day. Merle Hoffman, welcome.
Good to be with you, Sunsara. Very good.
I think it'd be helpful to take a moment and talk about, why is abortion so central? Why have you dedicated your life to ensuring that women have this access? What did it mean before this right was available? And why is this so essential? What do you understand about this?
Well, my journey was very serendipitous. You know, I started out as a concert pianist, and then I was going to graduate school to be a psychologist. And one of the positions I was working with was with a physician who was quite progressive and decided to offer women in New York legal abortion services when abortion was decriminalized in New York. Now, most people know that the Roe decision happened in 1973, but before that, there were five states that decriminalized, made abortion legal. New York was one of them. So I got involved, you know, in a sense, landing on a different planet, you see, because if you think about it, on a Monday, abortion was a crime, a sin, it was illegal, it was the worst thing one could do. And then on Tuesday, you had women lining up, flying from all over the country to get abortions in New York. And I was motivated by the first patient that I saw, and she came from New Jersey because abortion was illegal in New Jersey at that time. And she was white, she was married, and she was Catholic, and she had three children, and she had a tremendous economic burden, and she just could not have another child. And I was 25 years old, and I, you know, there was no such thing as counseling, Sunsara. There was no such thing as women's health. It was just me and this woman who were entering this entire new world, this new reality. And I talked to her and I stayed with her and I held her hand during her abortion. And for me, it was the most powerful, moving experience, because I was with her at what I would consider the most vulnerable and powerful moment of her life, you see, deciding whether or not to let the fetus that was growing within her come to term. And I just felt, I felt an epiphany at that point in time. And you know, it was not only the patients, it was just doing everything for the first time. You know, it was extremely pioneering. How I got political was through the Hyde Amendment. And I don't know if everybody knows what this is, but in 1977, Henry Hyde decided, because he couldn't save all the babies, he was just going to save the babies of the poor. So he cut off federal aid for abortion, just allowing the aid to continue for prenatal care. Now, these were my patients. I saw middle, lower middle, poor women, Medicaid patients. And I thought to myself, this is absolutely egregious. How can this be? You can't discriminate like this. And so my first political action in my entire life, I went up to my office, I took out a piece of paper, I created a pamphlet, and I decided I'm going to distribute this to Queens College, where I had graduated from a year or so before.
You spoke about the history of the resistance at St. Patrick's Cathedral that you and others were part of.
Right.
And we're going back this Sunday. So I want you to talk about what's going to happen there, what you'd like to see there, why you think this is so important, and why others should come out.
Well, I think it's very important that we make the statement again. I think it's important. You see, I think that the anti-choice movement has holdouts in women's consciousness. There is still an amazing amount of shame and guilt, and women are afraid to say, I had an abortion, because, you know, good girls don't have abortions. Good girls don't, quote unquote, kill their babies, and you just don't talk about it. But you know, 1 in 4 of American women have had and are scheduled to have an abortion in their lifetime. So you think about that. 1 in 4 of the millions of American women and girls. Then you think about their partners, their friends, their parents, their loved ones. And that's an extraordinary constituency. Where are they? Where are they? So I am, you know, cursed or blessed to be the one crying in the wilderness. Look at what's happening. Speak out. You know, own the responsibility of your choice. Own what's happened to you in the decision that you've made. And I would love, what would I like to see? Thousands in the street, you know? What do I expect to see? As many as come out. You know I'm going to be there. So that's I have to only speak for my actions. I think we're also going to have some civil disobedience. We're going to have, hopefully, women who will testify, and perhaps men who have been with them will testify about what it meant to go through that experience.
I know you've been putting a challenge to people. What are you going to do? So I want to give you an opportunity, if you have any further challenge for people tuning in, watching, that you want to leave them with.
Well, I want you to look in the mirror. You know, there's so many people who come to me and say, oh, my God, Merle, you've been doing this for 50 years and it's worse than it was before. And, you know, aren't you depressed? How can you live with this? And I say, no, I'm not depressed. I understand that this is a generational struggle. I'm privileged to be part of the process. And I am acting through my conscience. My actions speak to who I am. And there are so many women I speak to that say, I can't believe this is happening. You know, I marched 40, 50 years ago. How can this be happening? That's when I say, look in the mirror, ask yourself, what have you done? And then ask the question, what will you do? And when you and I were in front of the Supreme Court a couple of weeks ago, we ended with the great Hillel quote, you know, if not now, when? If not us, then who? I mean, who is going to do this for us? It really means responsibility. So what I'd leave everyone with is, take the responsibility, take the risk. This is a matter of conscience, your daughter's lives, their daughter's lives, and speak out. And if you can't speak, support us. Support us by giving money, by even, you know, going there and standing there without speaking. But just put your body on the line of others who are saying, this is important. This is critical. That's what I would leave you with. Do it. Just do it.
Well, I concur. And I know you're going to back that up with your own actions. And I'll be there with you this Sunday. I can't wait. And March 8th, everybody's going to come out in even bigger numbers and join us in the streets in New York City and around the country. Thank you, Merle Hoffman. It's been a great pleasure.
Thank you, Sunsara Taylor, for always being there on this issue. Thank you so much.
Look, I think by now it should be clear that this is a time for everybody. Every single one of you watching to stand up and be counted and to organize and mobilize others to stand up in this fight. It should be clear that there is a nightmare coming. A world of hurt for women, and really a nightmare for humanity if we let this assault go down and women lose the right to abortion. But it is also very important, and I want to end this segment with this, that if we fight this, this is a winnable battle. There are millions who could be mobilized to stand up against this. We can shake this society and we can back up what these fascists think they can get away with. We can force them to respond to our demand through struggle. And this is what's needed now. We need courage. We need people to step in very urgently in many different ways. And as part of this, as you're doing this, I want to challenge everybody watching to think very deeply about what kind of a system do we live under? We're 50 years after this right was won, it is being taken away violently. And so much of what people have fought for and won is being rolled back as well, with the future of humanity on the line. What kind of system is this? And dig into the answers that we get into in this show, the Revolution Nothing Less show. Go to the website, rev.com.us. Dig into the work and the leadership Bob Avakian is providing to get at the root of all of this in this system and to bring alive how there is a bright and a beautiful future possible through an actual revolution. And how the struggle of women, unleashing the fury of women as a mighty force for revolution, could be a driving force in this. So there's a beautiful future to win as well as a nightmare to prevent. So I want to really invite you into that fully, in the most immediate sense in the streets in the coming days, and in the fullest sense with the future of humanity as something that we could actually really make a beautiful and bright thing through our struggle.
So with that, I want to say goodnight, Sunsara. I'm looking forward to doing the next edition of the RNL show, the Revolution Nothing Less show, with you in New York City next week.
Andy, it's so good to be with you. I want to send my love to you and everybody in the crew there in LA and to everybody tuning in.
All right. So that brings us to the close of episode 90 of the RNL Revolution Nothing Less show. Stay tuned to our channel here on YouTube, the RevComs. There could be dispatches that we put up later this week about the situation in Ukraine that we will certainly have more material on revcom.us. And I want to speak to you frankly about the situation we face putting this show together every week. You know that I'm coming to you from a studio that we've rented in Los Angeles and put together. And we want to thank the people who donated the seed money to be able to get the basic equipment we need. But we require a substantial amount of funds to put a show like this on every week. We have an incredible all-volunteer staff. So I'm asking you for two things. One, if you know people who are interested in this show, who have a heart to fight for something really worth fighting for revolution, and who have a desire to learn about video and about reporting and about audio, or who have those, especially those who have those abilities, that training already, we need to know, meet them, and they need to be introduced to the show. Write us at therevcoms@gmail.com. And more than that, we need funds to keep this show running. It's very expensive to keep this going. And so you can do that either by becoming a Patreon and giving a regular donation, or send us a donation now to be able to continue to support the work of the RNL Revolution Nothing Less show. So with that, we are in a very heavy moment. There's the necessity for all of you to spread the word about the battle for abortion rights and for riseupforabortionrights.org, and to come out on International Women's Day, March 8th. And if in New York City, get out to St. Patrick's Cathedral on the 27th at 1:30 p.m. and spread this show everywhere. We need to have thousands and thousands of people watching every week. And with that, good night, and we'll see you next week.